Welcome back to Curious Archive. This video is the finale of my two-part series on the biology of Darwin IV, an alien planet explored in the book Expedition by Wayne Barlowe, which I have a link to in the description. On this perilous world, deadly predators, strange herbivores, and uncategorizable oddities are still waiting to be discovered. So follow along on this first-hand account of an expedition across a spectacular planet, a journey that will end with an encounter with a mysterious observer. I am now 1 week into my survey of Darwin IV. To the east of the amoebic sea, I encounter the monolithic skull of an emperor sea strider that appears to have died long ago. I notice a herd of short-legged herbivores called literalopes taking cover at the skull's base. I soon realize what they're hiding from. A shadow swoops overhead. The literalopes scatter in all directions. In the resulting panic, a lone literalope is knocked to the ground with a heavy thud, and the shadow swoops in from above. This aerial predator is called a skewer, and it is the uncontested ruler of the skies of Darwin IV, with a wingspan of almost 50 feet, or 15 meters. At a glance, the monstrous skewers almost resemble biological stealth aircrafts. While the idea of an animal converging on a jet-like shape might seem surprising, the real anatomy of certain birds of prey and stealth aircrafts are quite similar due to the universal constraints of aerodynamics. The skewers take this convergence to a new level, however, through their ability to internally create methane gas, which is then combusted within the four jet pods located on their wings for propulsion. And when a skewer chooses a target, the hunt is already over. I watch as a skewer rises into the air and pitches downward with its stinger pointed forwards. In an instant, it impales its prey. I count myself lucky I'm too small to be its target. Yet as I watch the skewer fly off, I get the strange feeling I'm not alone. Even as I continue on, I feel like something is watching me. Putting these feelings aside for now, further east, I reach a sprawling flatland where the margins of the amoebic sea have receded. Within this region, which was once the sea floor, I spot a sac-back, a bulky red life form with peculiar anatomy. This species gets their name from a sac used to store predigested food from the amoebic sea, almost like the world's weirdest camel's hump. Even stranger, however, is that this sac-back stored food isn't for itself, but for its mate. Under the sand, a second sac-back has buried itself up to its head, along with its eggs, and relies on the above-ground partner to bring it food. Strange as this might sound, Earth hornbills exhibit a highly convergent behavior. When a hornbill needs to incubate its eggs, it completely seals itself within its nest, while its mate dutifully brings it regurgitated food for a period lasting up to 4 months. It's a risky endeavor, which requires a tremendous amount of trust between the two parents. So, it is strangely moving that such a social behavior would arise not just on Earth, but on a planet as perilous as Darwin IV. Journeying to the south, I find myself face to face with a rather unsightly creature. This is a bladderhorn, an animal that is so bizarre it is at first difficult to categorize. It lives at the base of an equatorial mountain range, and thankfully seems to feed on plants rather than other life forms. With their mid-sized grazing niche and bellowing calls, these creatures are in many ways the elk of Darwin IV. Another bladderhorn approaches from behind. The first one isn't happy with this invader, and bellows while it inflates its glowing horns. When this fails, the two butt heads. Like birds of paradise, these bladderhorns appear to engage in bizarre displays over territory and mating rights. Indeed, many birds of paradise rituals are just as strange as the alien bladderhorns, which is saying something. I decide to leave the bladderhorns to it, and see what other life forms dwell in this mountain range. Scaling the foothills of the equatorial mountains, I find myself caught in a heavy rainfall. Taking shelter under an overhanging rock, I realize two leathery brown creatures are huddled nearby, also hiding from the storm. These are keeled sliders, peaceful mountainous herbivores which thankfully aren't aggravated by my presence. Like mountain goats, keeled sliders can maneuver down steep slopes with remarkable ease using their specialized front limbs. Yet these keeled sliders are staying remarkably still. A scan detects 20 small life forms in the tiny cave behind the pair. It seems these are young parents guarding a nest of newborns. I don't want to disrupt them, and since the rain is letting up, I'll be on my way. After a grueling climb, I reach the summit of the equatorial mountains. Looking to the horizon as I catch my breath, I spot a herd of four-legged grazers on the peaks beside me. These are springwings, and while they look ordinary from a distance, springwings are the champions of the chilly alpine skies. A gust of wind howls overhead. I look up and see an adult springwing leaping into the air above me, unfurling gliding appendages that allow it to soar out into the abyss. Watching a cow-sized organism take flight is a majestic and bizarre sight, made possible thanks to Darwin IV's thick atmosphere and low gravity. Their fixed-wing structure resembles the body plan of Draco lizards, which can glide in a similar manner, although they're much smaller. Just as I'm about to depart, I notice something moving on the rock above me, but it quickly recedes from view. It seems I am still being observed. Heading northwards, I'm drawn to a commotion caused by a stampeding herd. These behemoths are called Unths, creatures named for the sound they make when they exhale through their dorsal vents. Heavy-set herbivores, Unths are the lumbering bison of Darwin IV, who rely on their herd to stay safe while they browse for plants. Yet Unth herds aren't without conflict. Before my eyes, two Unths engage in an earth-shaking battle for dominance. Throwing their full weight into each other, their posturing reminds me of muskox clashes on Earth. Yet despite the occasional clash, the Unth herd seems to be remarkably tight-knit, as they are united against a common enemy. The weather. This far to the north, nothing is more dangerous than the dropping temperatures. I've now reached a windswept region where the ground is covered in near-permanent ice, and most life forms on Darwin IV can't survive for long. Yet even in this extreme biome, some creatures have found a way to adapt to the cold. Close by, I notice an organism which at first glance appears to be in distress, as it's half buried in the snow at an awkward angle. Looking closer, however, I realize that this creature, called a tundra plow, is actually scouring under the surface for food. Plenty of earth animals forage for food under the ground, and many others tunnel under the snow for similar reasons. But the tundra plow makes such behaviors look extremely tame by comparison, staying halfway underground in a manner that looks like a faceplant for long periods. It's a somewhat absurd method of survival, but it appears to be working reasonably well. Trekking as far north as I can safely travel, I've reached a glacier cap where only the most extreme species can live. Here, I find the shivering ice crawlers, small nondescript organisms that slowly make their way across the glacier's surface, feeding on microorganisms with a mouth on the underside of their shell. With their segmented bodies, the ice crawlers have converged on a body plan similar to giant isopods, crustaceans that can also endure frigid temperatures. I'm about to turn back when perhaps the strangest life form I've seen dashes across my field of vision. This is a Rimerunner, a fast-moving creature that hops over the ice on its single foot. While a single-legged animal is highly unusual, it's not altogether unheard of in the natural world, as most bivalve mollusks like clams also possess only a single foot, which they use as a bizarre form of motion. It's likely that the Rimerunner evolved from a similar organism. Even stranger than this creature's foot, however, is the parachute-shaped structure on the front of its head. At first, I thought this orange structure was a separate life form, but it's actually connected to the Rimerunner via a thin neural cable. Looking closely at the floating organ, it seems it's a sensory packet that helps the Rimerunner better navigate through echolocation, almost like an organic radar dish, a unique life form indeed. Returning to the warmth of the southern reaches, I worry I won't find creatures as strange as the Rimerunner. My worries quickly fade, however, when I spot two crescent-shaped life forms hovering in the distance. These wrinkled oddities are Rugose Floaters. Rather lazy creatures, they fly in wide, slow circles. A scan tells me they're able to stay aloft thanks to internal sacs of buoyant gas. This leads me to wonder, if the bulky Rugose Floaters can fly using this method, might a true giant be hidden in the skies? I soon get my answer. The largest airborne creature of Darwin IV breaches through the clouds. This is an Ebony Blisterwing, an animal that is longer than even the Emperor's Sea Striders I glimpsed earlier in this expedition, although much lighter and more fragile. While I'm only able to glimpse this creature for a moment, I can theorize that Ebony Blisterwing stays aloft using the bubble-like bladders on its wings and body, which keep it afloat like giant balloons. And while the diet of this majestic being is unknown, I suspect it feeds on airborne microscopic organisms, filtering them from the skies much like a baleen whale filters zooplankton from the ocean. It is now my final day on Darwin IV. Just as I'm returning to my launch site, from the skies descends the most important life form I've seen. This is an Eosapien, a highly unusual yet clearly complex floating organism that hovers in the air, and seems to be observing me with quiet intelligence. I realize this is my mysterious follower, and it is Darwin IV's version of intelligent life. In its hands, it holds a carved, defensive weapon. Not wanting to alarm the Eosapien with any sudden movements, I sit for a while and map out its anatomy. The Eosapien's brain appears to be housed somewhere in its central body, likely close to its sensory organs. Furthermore, the Eosapien also possesses flexible digits that enable tool crafting. While right now it seems Eosapiens are only crafting rudimentary tools, perhaps long into the future they will build a civilization here on Darwin IV. For a species like the Eosapien, the future is full of exciting possibilities. Seemingly content with its own observations, the Eosapien departs. Watching the Eosapien leave reminds me that the time has come for me to also return home. But if you enjoyed this expedition across Darwin IV as much as I did, I once again encourage you to purchase the book and check out more of Wayne Barlowe's incredible work. As always, links are in the description. Also, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this entry, please lend your support to help make videos like this possible by liking, subscribing, and hitting the notification icon to stay up to date on all things curious. See you in the next video.